Okay, hello. This is the Modern Education Radio Hour. I'm your host, Ben Woodford. We're here on 90.1 KZSU Stanford. This is a show where we dig into everything from current research trends to far-out ideas concerning any topic even remotely related to education. I'm Ben Woodford here in the studio. I'll be with you every Friday from 3 until 4 p.m. Here at Modern Education, we bring cutting-edge ideas, philosophical discussions, insights from experts, and just about anything else you want to know. The goal is to help listeners interact with and understand learning. If you have questions or suggestions for future shows, you can tweet me at BenWoodford1 on Twitter. I'll do my best to include your ideas in future shows. If you're a teacher, parent, student, or anyone interested in our collective future, I hope you'll tune in each week as we examine new ideas and interview guests from a variety of backgrounds. My guest in the studio today is John Wilinsky. John is the Khosla Family Professor of Education here at Stanford University and part-time professor of publishing studies at SFU. And a distinguished scholar in residence at the SFU Library. John started the Public Knowledge Project in 1998 at the University of British Columbia in an effort to create greater public and global access to research and scholarship through the use of new publishing technologies. He is the author of various books, which we will be discussing today. John, welcome to the studio. Thanks for coming.
Well, thank you, Ben. It's a pleasure to be here.
Oh, it's the pleasure's all mine. So, Professor Wilinsky, is it okay? It's okay if I call you John?
John, please.
Excellent. Okay. So, can we start by just giving the listeners a glimpse of the path you've taken through learning and education yourself and maybe highlight the background and some of your experiences?
Sure, Ben. I started my career, at least, as a school teacher. I taught for 10 years in Northern Ontario, from grades 3 to about 8. And in that time, I worked a lot on literacy, math, music, all of the subject areas. But I was troubled by a number of issues in terms of literacy actually was one of the main concerns for me in terms of students' enthusiasm for literature, their ability to understand texts, and to generally be literate citizens. So from there, I went back to graduate school to see if I could find some answers. And I have to say to you, as a doctoral student, that's a not as easy as I thought it would be. I don't know how it is for you.
I'm realizing that myself, yeah.
Yes. The questions come more easily. So I went through graduate school and I became, I got a PhD. I became a professor of education. I trained particularly English high school teachers for a long period. And then at one point, something happened.
Yeah.
I had a significant epiphany. What took place is I was working with a local newspaper in Vancouver, the Vancouver Sun, and we did a project together in which I would bring the research and they would do the reporting on computers in the schools. And the significant thing was we were getting on famously in terms of the combination of journalism and scholarship until I wanted to put the research online, until I wanted to share what researchers and scholars had learned about the use of computers in schools onto the web screens of the readers of the newspaper.
Oh, wow.
And then
why is that a problem?
I know, because the journals are proprietary. They're owned by the publishers. And even this is in 1998, if you can think back that far to the early days of the web, they had agreements with the libraries that said that the material could not be shared outside of the library and that I would not be allowed to share it online for the readers of the local newspaper. And I decided there was a problem there, that everything I had tried to do in terms of literacy and kids was running into a roadblock if I couldn't share this important work.
Yeah. And so that led, I guess, to you becoming the director of the Public Knowledge Project.
Yeah.
So can you explain what that is or what the goals of the project are then?
Sure. This was a wildly ambitious kind of concept. I mean, it's clear a Public Knowledge Project would be about making knowledge public. But in particular, it was about making the knowledge that the universities were producing. It was making the research and the work that's in the libraries available in a public form. Now, what was ridiculously ambitious, I'm afraid, was the notion it would be just a project. I mean, how long would it take to convince faculty members to share their work publicly, to convince publishers to take off the restrictions that were keeping it from going public? to convince libraries to open their doors to, well, they would always open their doors to everyone, but to open their websites.
Yeah.
So that was 20 years ago. and where we are today, Ben, is that I can say, with some confidence, a number of studies have shown that the recent research that's been published, about 50%, 40 to 50% of it is freely available to your physician, to the school teachers, to interested readers.
Okay. So you've made some real headway since the 98.
And not me alone. we're kind of a movement. The term we use is open access to research and scholarship. And there are people all over the world. In fact, when we started, there weren't that many. But now the major publishers, the funding agencies, that is the governments behind them, groups like the Gates Foundation, all of them are very enthusiastic about open access. People's right to knowledge and learning. We haven't quite decided on the way to get there in terms of 100% or universal, but we're halfway there.
Okay. So I would like to just get a little bit more specific. You said you're the director of this public knowledge project, right? So
yes.
What does the project actually do?
Ah, good question. So the project, we tried many things, but what's been most effective is we developed software to help the journals publish. We developed open source software, that is software that is freely distributed. It's called Open Journal Systems.
Mm-hmm.
And the publishers can use that to accept submissions, to conduct the blind review that distinguishes scholarship, to edit, copy edit, and layout and publish. And
okay.
So by making the platform free,
yeah.
We thought that would immediately, in 2001, convince everyone to make the research free. We were a little naive. But right now, we have 10,000 journals around the world that use our software, Open Journal Systems, and 95% of them are making their content totally free to readers.
Wow.
So it is part of the contribution. We learned very early that it's not enough to exhort people, please make your work free. What you have to do is you have to provide them something more than an argument. You have to give them tools.
Right. So you essentially created a platform that made it easy for the publishers to do this if they wanted to.
That's right. And lots don't, of course.
Right.
And we still have 50% of the literature locked up, in a sense, to subscribers only. So it's been one part of our efforts. I do research in this question, as you know, and we build software. We have education programs. We do advocacy for open access.
Okay.
So it's a whole court press, if you on this question of how can we increase access to knowledge.
Yeah, and it's such an important issue. I think it's worth putting all of that time and 20 years of your life into.
Oh, thank you. I was worried for a moment there, yes.
Right? I mean, 50% of them is a lot more than probably where you started. So
yes.
That's a great stride so far. So I wanted to talk more about this open access thing.
Yeah.
And when I hear it conjures up these images of information just being freely available to anyone, and you can just get whatever you need whenever you need it. Is that the idea, or maybe can you explain what open access isn't?
So open access is about access to research and scholarship. And I think I've devoted my life to this, and you have now enrolled your life into this idea that we do something special in the universities.
Yeah.
That there's a very difficult process involved in ensuring that the knowledge that we produce, the information that I want everyone to share, what we do in the name of research and scholarship has a special quality to it.
Yeah.
And I think it's easy to say that today, if there ever was a time when we're in need of reliable and authoritative knowledge, and not final knowledge, not absolute knowledge, but qualified in terms of what we know today and what we can verify today, there's a need for that. And so I see it as something that journalists should be able to use. I see it as something that obviously teachers, educators should be able to use, parents, but even interested people on the street.
Yeah.
The amateur astronomer, someone interested in the quality of the stream in their backyard, someone concerned about climate change. Everyone should have that right to know what, in fact, the universities, which are public institutions, which are tax exempt in most cases, if not publicly funded directly, We're producing something that we think of as a public good, and we haven't quite brought it up to scale in terms of the internet's concept of what it means to have access to something.
Yeah, so it sounds like you're saying basically that these universities are, you know, paid for partially by taxpayers, and they're producing, essentially extending the body of knowledge for humanity. And all you're saying is humanity should have access to that?
Yes. I mean, it's not, you know, to say it's free is a bit of a misnomer. What I'm saying is we need to maximize that access. So you still need an internet connection. You need a computer. We're putting it online.
Right.
But today, that seems a very reasonable thing, that we can increase the access to this knowledge. We're not handing it out on the bus or anything. We're just saying online it should be freely available. And I think the recognition, for example, of the National Institutes of Health, the U.S. government's, all of its research funding now is tied to making this work freely available within 12 months and possibly the final draft. So there's still some compromises. There's still some accommodation of the publisher's needs to make money in order to pay for the publishing. I don't imagine that this research is free. I don't imagine it can be produced for no cost. But what I'm thinking, and what many of us are hoping, is that we can find economic models by which the work can be freely distributed and reasonably paid for and to be produced in a professional manner.
Yeah, and I'm sure that paid for piece makes a lot more people on your team, because people like to make money off of their work.
The thing I think we have to be clear about is the researchers are already paid.
Yeah.
The faculty members receive a salary, and in fact, we have to publish in order to maintain our places.
Right.
You know the old expression, the parish, publisher perish.
Right.
Indeed. So that part is, we don't get paid for the research that we publish directly from the publishers, but publishers have real costs for sure.
Yeah.
They do copy editing, they lay it out professionally, they publish it on platforms, if not my free platform, they publish it on platforms they have to pay for. My hope is, in fact, my argument is, Ben, if I can jump right to
is
that we have enough money on the table.
Okay.
That there is about $10 billion being currently spent on subscriptions that end up locking up or end up restricting access to this knowledge. The libraries are writing most of the checks behind that $10 billion.
Oh, wow.
And so the simplest solution, and not really solution, the simplest way of thinking about this and moving towards a solution is to say that what if we wrote that same check for $10 billion, the libraries collectively all around the world.
Mm-hmm.
You can just imagine that for a moment.
Not really. It's a huge number.
It is a huge number. It'd be a lot of pens moving at the same time, checks and everything. But let's just for a moment. This is radio, after all. You can use your imagination.
Paint us a picture. Exactly.
Yes, yes. That's the freedom of radio. I don't have to show you a picture.
Yeah.
So all of the libraries around the world write this collective check for $10 billion, much as they have done last year and the year before, and maybe it's going up a little bit each year, or maybe too much each year. And then we say one thing's different this year. Instead of writing a check for $10 billion in order to lock up everything that is published, we're going to write the same check, which you need as a publisher in order to publish, write the same check, only this time it's all freely available.
Wow, yeah. So you're essentially saying spend the money we're already spending in a way that makes the usefulness of it more widespread.
That's right. And the usefulness is a very key point. Usefulness would go up. The value of that research would increase multiple times because physicians around the world who don't have access right now would, and others would have access, and they would put it to use, whether in a classroom, whether in a doctor's office, an operating room,
right,
whether in a legal office, whether in a state legislature.
Yeah. So people will benefit from this in all these different fields, and there's already the money on the table to do it. It seems like a slam dunk.
Well, and we actually have research. We do, you know, I don't know if you know this, but we do research on these sorts of things. So we do know that if you make your work freely available, and we do in the Graduate School of Education, we have a policy of sharing our work, the final draft of our work.
Mm-hmm.
So studies have been done to show that the readership of work that is made freely available goes up. Highly, 60%, 80% increases in readership if it's freely available. And it even gets used in the sense of being cited by other researchers.
Right.
So there's studies that have shown a 3 times increase in the number of citations for a paper that is made freely available.
Wow.
Comparing papers in a journal where some professors make it freely available through their own efforts and other professors just leave it locked up in the journal. Those have shown increases in citation and very strong increases in terms of readership.
Wow. So there's really no drawback for professors either, because they're putting in the work, they're already getting paid to produce the work, and the best outcome for making a sizable contribution is to get people to read it,
Absolutely.
To cite it, to use it, to extend it even.
Now, they may get some funny emails back. They mm-hmm. may get some blowback in terms of, you know, what is it you're doing with our federal money? So I don't want, I think... One of the questions is that some people prefer academic freedom through obscurity.
Huh.
That is,
what do you mean by that?
That means that I can work freely because no one knows what I'm doing.
Oh.
And I think that's a weak defense of academic freedom.
Yeah.
I'd rather that we stop for a moment and explain to the public, as if we were responsible citizens as well as researchers,
yeah.
what it is we're doing with our federal funding or our philanthropic contributions that have come from different sources. So my argument is that it will increase the interest and it will raise some interesting questions about the work we do.
Yeah.
And let's have it. Bring it on. Let's talk about the
right.
value of our research.
Right. Absolutely. I mean,
which is actually what we're doing right at
oh,
this
yeah,
moment.
Yeah. Right this minute.
Live.
Yeah. We're doing that. Yeah. So, John, I wanted to jump back a little bit. You mentioned about a human right, right? Access to knowledge being a human right.
Yes.
Can you give me an example of how you see that being the case?
Yes. I mean, this is the Universal Declaration of Human Rights that Eleanor Roosevelt was involved in. Actually, it contains a clause to this effect, that we have a right not only to the benefits mm-hmm. of medicine, such as the aspirin, for example, but we have a right to that knowledge itself. And so the idea that we have a right to know what is known, to me, is fundamental. I wouldn't be an educator if I didn't think
Right.
And hold to that principle.
Right.
And so this is not to say that people have a right to know everything, you know, in terms of the government or security or different kinds of issues. But in the case of something that is created as a public good,
yeah.
I think of it as a right. And to deny that can have profound consequences. I keep coming back to the doctor's office because
mm-hmm.
There's a place where medical research is not freely available unless you're working in a university hospital.
Right.
But otherwise, if you don't have that affiliation, physicians, healthcare providers, families that are concerned. In fact, one of the interesting things we're discovering is that families are educating doctors. They're finding
Wow.
some of the free research that's available. Remember, it's up to 50%.
Right.
They're finding some of that, and they're bringing it into physicians. And originally, the work suggested that doctors were a little apprehensive about that,
uh-huh.
a little took it as an affront. But the more recent work suggests now that doctors are grateful. They don't have time to sometimes find this work.
Right.
And it changes the dynamics. Think about it as a doctor physician. We sometimes use the expression, the tyranny of expertise.
Right.
Where the patient feels like they have no choice. They have to be passive recipient of whatever the doctor says. And all of a sudden the patient says, yes, but I read a study that says this and that. And the doctor says, well, that's not quite your condition. Let me explain it to you. And even in that case, the dynamic has changed.
Yeah, yeah.
So the human right thing is about a democratic access or the democratic quality of our lives around something like the purpose of education, which is the ability to use knowledge to our benefit and to others' benefit.
Yeah, yeah. That's such a great example, too, because it really puts in perspective, you know, doctors shouldn't have structures in place that discourage them from staying up on the current research. And that's essentially what a paywall does for like
yes.
a small family physician.
So there's now a thing called information prescriptions that some doctors give to patients. So to increase their sense of having a right or a power over their own condition.
Right.
Very much the women's movement had that phrase, our bodies, ourselves,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to saying, whatever you think, doctor, I'm happy to do.
Yeah.
So doctors are now thinking more about how they can prescribe information, where patients can look for information. And my concern is that information should include all of the recent research. Certainly, the patient's not in a position to interpret it, and heaven forbid they should be acting on it, but for them to engage in a conversation about what they're learning, to me, is an educational moment. And, of course, my secret ambition as a school teacher is always to increase the number of educational moments in each person's life.
Yeah, well, it's not a secret anymore. You just told everybody. Oh, well, secret's out.
Yeah.
So I wanted to ask just for your average everyday person, right? We got the example where someone going into the doctor's office can benefit from understanding their condition better. And we're not handing out research papers on the bus. So what is the average person? Where do you see them fitting a place in all this?
Yes, I don't think of them rushing home each evening to check the latest research results.
Right.
I think it's a just-in-time kind of situation. So there's a concern at their school about Spanish immersion. They want to understand better how that program's going to work, how it's going to affect their children. It seems like a wonderful opportunity. So just in time, they can go online and look at the latest work on, in fact, the benefits of enrolling your child in Spanish immersion. So there, that it is on more on that basis in certain circumstances. But I also don't want to make it always about a particular need.
Right.
That we, in fact, I've learned a lot about amateur astronomers.
Mm-hmm.
The role that they play, one of the theories is that if a comet is going to hit the Earth, it'll be the amateur astronomers who are going to warn us because they're watching the sky unfailingly in a way that professional or scholarly astronomers are working on their papers, they're booking time at an observatory, and it's a different kind of order of attention, if you like. So the role of amateur learners in terms of science fairs, in terms of astronomers, in terms of hobbyists in these fields, you should be able to go further and further. Wikipedia is one really good example.
Yeah.
One of the projects we're working on is thinking about how Wikipedia can be more a gateway to learning rather than an endpoint.
Okay.
Now, I go to Wikipedia all the time, and many times I just stop after I've read the facts. Mm-hmm. How many home runs did Babe Ruth really hit and that sort of thing? But often you can click through the research resources, through the links in Wikipedia, and you can hit a paywall. But another time when you click on one of those links, you can go right through and read the research on how the stats were calculated for Babe Ruth and how statistics have changed in baseball.
Right.
And so, again, this idea that we can go further than we've ever gone in terms of learning, whether it's an urgent issue around patient or your family's health, or whether it's just a curiosity about the world, those two aspects I would be delighted to contribute to, and my interest in open access to research and scholarship is motivated by that interest.
Oh, that's great. Yeah. And yeah, it just really makes me think in some ways it maybe people wouldn't know necessarily what to do with the research, but on the other hand, that's like not a risk. It's not going to hurt anyone if someone reads something and doesn't know exactly where it came from or how to interpret it. It's better to start looking and trying and then move from there.
There are cases. I mean, these are brought to my attention whenever people can, where studies are imitated by people way too early in the process, where they find something works well on mice. And they publish that openly, and then there are stories about people going to drugstores and recreating the experiment on mice on themselves.
Oh, wow.
Exactly. So that's the kind of horror story that is said, that is put in front of me by people who are saying open access is a risk, is a danger.
Wow.
Now, those stories are not apocryphal. They're probably true, but they are so rare that I want to go the other way. I want people to understand that there are new medications being developed that you should not yet try.
Right.
That mice are not humans. I want people to feel that they have a right to this knowledge, and I want to see that as a risk in terms of how we educate. Because the biggest, what I'm arguing in a sense, is the biggest change ahead of us in terms of education is the amount of knowledge that will be available to citizens.
Yeah.
Now, the amount of knowledge available to researchers will be relatively the same because we always had the access through subscriptions.
Right.
But now the public is going to have this access, and will they have a way of finding research? Will they have a way of interpreting it? Well, that's a lot to ask. Will they have a way of asking questions about it?
Mm.
Will they be able to become involved in setting the agenda for research in a way that they haven't? And the ACT UP movement during the crisis of, around AIDS, the epidemic in the 90s, what the ACT UP movement established is that patients have rights around knowledge, both in access to it, the setting of the agenda, control over the way in which experiments or drugs were being put through experimental processes. And so that kind of movement, that kind of human rights movement that ACT UP represented, for me is something that speaks to what we should all, and we can now technically, we can now in terms of the infrastructures that we have, can all have access to this, this a learning in a very basic sense and research and scholarship in a more formal sense.
Yeah, that's great. And I think the more we improve our education system, the more people will know what to do with this access.
Yeah, so that's a new thing that we need to start thinking about.
Right.
I mean, my colleague Sam Weinberg has been working on helping students understand how it is you can check or kind of probe the trust and authority of websites, to not be misled by websites and by advertising, by other forms. I mean, the web, the level of misinformation or, no, sorry, make that disinformation, the level is increasing.
Yeah.
And so on the one hand, we need to inform in our schools some form of protection around that, some form of checks in terms of students being able to assess. And at the same time, we need to prepare them for a level of access that they've never had, that their parents haven't had, in terms of being able to say, what is the relevant research and what should I bring to my doctor's office and what studies are going on that might be relevant, on the one hand, and then on the other, my curiosity about pollution in my neighborhood or climate change on a global scale. What can I discover?
Yeah. So do you see this, like, just kind of taking in another direction for a second, do you see this working its way into primary education and things like that?
Yeah, I mean, we need to do some research. Have you heard that expression? We need more research on this question.
That's thrown around a lot around
that
here,
is.
Yeah.
So I have no problem thinking about it in terms of high schools.
Okay.
Because in high schools, in a sense, we, in chemistry, as much as in history, we're teaching fairly sophisticated knowledge.
Right.
And for students to be able to understand the ongoing discussion about the Civil War, for example, in this country, that history is not something that was fixed in their parents' generation or in any generation. That we're still in a process of interpretation.
Yeah.
So I have no problem there. Now, when you say primary school, well, there may be a question, but even there, I would hope that the primary school teachers would be interested in questions about immersion classes and questions about diversity and questions about gender identity and among their students, that they would want to learn more about and have somewhere to turn for that work. And because of our responsibility as researchers to look into these questions, to explore important social issues, and to wrestle with finding evidence and establishing a basis for reasoning about these questions, we're in a position to provide not answers, but we're in a position to inform decisions across the school grades. And I hope, well, between primary and high school, we have that middle school period. So maybe that's where the interesting things will happen when I discover that kids have a capacity that we didn't realize. One of the things we've discovered with open access is that people are able to go further in the medical research than we ever imagined. That if you're motivated, if there is someone in your family that is ill, there are a number, not many, I would say, but there are a number of instances where families have educated themselves and have gone into where we would have said, no, that's way above your reading level, or, you know, this is way too sophisticated, but have in fact gone in and through repeated exposure to this work, through just plain diligence and hard work, have understood and got a grip on the research that's relevant to their family's condition. Or someone in their family's condition.
Yeah, that really speaks a lot to the power of a self-motivated learner, somebody who wants to dig into an idea.
That's been the secret of reading instruction for a long time. The idea that it involves motivation, involves skills, involves background knowledge, but motivation in the first instance. And what we're seeing with open access is that those who do go, and again, not everybody's going to go every day, but when they do, there's a motivation.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's almost just giving them a chance to follow that.
Exactly.
Which is powerful. Absolutely. So is there something that your average person could do to help this cause?
Yes. Be interested.
Okay.
I think it's a matter. The state of California right now is considering some legislation in this regard in terms of ensuring that state funding for research ends up in research that is available to the public.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say that even the use. So if your listeners were interested in health issues and they went to a website called PubMed.
Mm-hmm.
Not Club Med.
Okay,
that would be a mistake.
Right.
So not Grateful Med. That would be a bad pun. But PubMed, which is really the U.S. government's, is really the very best index in the health sciences.
Mm-hmm.
And they start looking for work that's of interest to them when they have a need.
Right.
So just use, public use,
yeah,
is a vote. That is, you're voting with your fingers, in this case, not your feet,
yeah,
but you're expressing an interest. And repeatedly, in fact, PubMed is such a good example because it was originally a project that was designed to help researchers find research very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
Al Gore was, remember the so-called father of the internet? Well, he's been the first to deny that as well. Or not the first, obviously, but he has denied that. But one thing Al Gore was involved in was putting the medical research that's now become PubMed online,
right,
for public use. And what was quickly discovered is the use exceeded the number of researchers by such a large number that it was clear that the public was interested.
Right.
Now, most of the research in those days was behind what we call a paywall.
Mm-hmm.
But today, remember how much of it is now freely available, the recent stuff?
50%.
You got it.
Yeah. Yeah, that's exciting. So you're saying literally people can just take some time to try to look for some research at PubMed or
Google Scholars, another open site to discover work.
Right. And their clicks essentially provide a vote to say this is important.
More than that, PubMed has a free full text filter. You can say only show me the work.
Mm-hmm.
That is freely available. And in fact, some of the work I do in my classes, we've been exploring just this week, which work is more available. So HIV/AIDS, it was 47% of the clinical trials were freely available. All of them, not just the recent ones.
Yeah.
Where other conditions, it escapes me right this minute, but other conditions were as low as 25 to 30% freely available.
Wow. Wow.
So it is, again, that expression of public interest. And again, we've focused on health, but Google Scholar covers all of the areas that anyone could possibly be interested, from game theory to the effect of the internet to social media to astronomy, that I keep coming back to as well. So it is, that would be a strong starting point. The other is to, another way is the newspapers are now including links to research. So if you read about a study involving cancer, there is likely going to be a link to that study.
Yeah.
And if your listeners were to click on that link, then it would be another kind of vote. Now, they might run into a paywall. We did a study, again, with newspapers, and it was over 50% of the links included on cancer articles, newspaper articles, ran into paywalls.
Oh, wow.
So you couldn't see it.
Yeah.
But even then, when you run yourself up against that paywall, it's a kind of expression.
Mm-hmm.
And my hope is, if I keep up this work long enough, that your listeners, when they do go and look at journalism articles on health issues, will, on every case, when they click on a link, they'll be able to find the original study. They'll be able to study, look at it, examine it, share it with their doctor, share it with their family.
Yeah, yeah.
That's the dream.
Well, I, for one, hope that you're successful and continue to fight this fight because someone needs to do it.
For sure.
Yeah, absolutely. So you have a book. You have quite a few books, actually. Looking around, I found quite a few. But your most recent book is called The Intellectual Properties of Learning, A Prehistory from St. Jerome to John Locke.
Yes, it is a new book. I've worked on it for some time. So what I do in that book is a little different. I have books that have been strictly advocacy of open access. But what hit me on the intellectual properties of learning was the idea of, where did this idea come from? How would I get into my head this crazy notion that research and scholarship should be as available as possible?
Right.
And so this is like the backstory.
Mm-hmm.
This is the story about where access was before the internet. It's a way of saying this is not just a Napster moment.
Okay.
That this is something that is part of our tradition.
Yeah.
Because I've had trouble convincing my colleagues at times to make their work freely available after they've published it. And I think maybe in their heads they're saying, oh, he wants to Napsterize our world. And so what I did with this book is I went back all the way to the 4th century, kind of a history of learning in the West, back to St. Jerome, to look at how this tradition of increasing access, of struggling, of maintaining, of sustaining access to learning has always been part of research and scholarship and is not simply a Napster spinoff.
Right.
And so I found fascinating characters, Hildegard of Bingen, an abbess, a nun who was walled into a monastery originally, but was able to and was inspired to share her learning to such an extent that she published on, this is in the 12th century, so her medicinal remedies are still used today. Oh, her music is still being sung today.
Yeah.
It was shared, and that she got outside the monastery and preached along the Rhine. So in each case, I look at how different scholars have contributed to a notion of intellectual property before there was even a word or a concept of intellectual property. I guess there was a concept, but the term intellectual property doesn't come until the 18th century. And so they were working in an earlier sense that we had a right of access to this knowledge, and I have a responsibility to share it.
Yeah, yeah.
And that, to me, is an important aspect of this whole question. That it's an older tradition that we need to maintain and sustain and take into the digital era in a new form. So no, I'm not asking us to go back to monasteries. And no, I'm not asking for illuminated well, actually, that'd be nice, illuminated manuscripts. They're certainly beautiful things, but I'm not asking us to go back to that. I'm asking us to carry forward the sense or the urgency that what we know needs to be shared as widely as possible.
Yeah, yeah, okay. So the book really traces this lineage all the way back and kind of paints the picture of how it came about and where it came from.
Yes, and it ends, so I call it a prehistory and kind of a bad joke because it's 1,400 years of prehistory. The book ends with John Locke and the beginning of formal intellectual property. The legislation that we think of as the first act of modern copyright is actually called the Statute of Anne, 1710. But its title is an act for the encouragement of learning.
Oh,
wow. So the first copyright was about encouraging learning, not for building a phone that no one can copy unless they want to go to court, not for protecting pop songs or other sorts of intellectual property. We first started copyright around a concept of encouraging learning. And part of my concern is that we don't lose sight of that aspect.
Yeah, so you're essentially just trying to keep us true to the intended purpose of this in
and
the first
a very
place.
Long tradition.
Wow.
And it actually ties into my musical background too, Ben.
Yeah, well, I was going to ask you about that next, actually. So you play music, you play guitar in a band, right? What's the name of your band?
The band is called Mayfield because we practice in the old town of Mayfield that doesn't quite exist anymore. And we talk about ourselves as a lost town and a new sound.
All right. And how long have you guys been playing together?
Us guys, so the band's been around for 11 years and people have come and gone. In fact, I may be the only one who's maintained that period. But let me try the open access concept to this, because our music is, we play cover songs, and those covers are based on people sharing their own transcriptions of popular music.
Oh, okay.
So it's something in the 90s that started when people started transcribing and tabbing, as it's called, the guitar music and bass music and drums. And so really our band is inspired by the open access of people sharing their own tabs or transcriptions of pop music.
Wow. So this has really permeated a lot of parts of your life.
Inspired.
Absolutely. Well, we're going to hear a song from your band right now, and we'll come back in a couple of minutes.
Do I soothe you?
Okay, I'm going to bring our guest back here. John, you ready?
Yes, sir.
Excellent. So let's get back to the questions. I got a lot for you here. So we're back in the studio with Professor John Wilinsky. We just discussed his most recent book, The Intellectual Properties of Learning, A Prehistory from St. Jerome to John Locke. And he's also written many other titles. And we also just heard a little bit from his band. Now, earlier in the show and through our previous conversations, I know you're really passionate about the open access to research and scholarly work. What are some of the challenges that get in the way of this actually happening?
Yeah, you would think it'd be an easy thing to do, that if people have a right to knowledge, then yeah, let's just open the libraries or let's just make all the publications online freely available. But part of the complication is that it is a major economy, that we have, as I mentioned before, about a $10 billion market for publications, scholarly publications. And so part of that is trying to decide how can we rearrange the financing? How can we ensure that the quality of publishing is maintained, the double-blind reviews, the editing, the layout design, websites, and all of that? In a way that maintains the quality, as I said, and to ensure that people have public free access. So that's one of the challenges. And I think part of it is the attitudes. Faculty members, my colleagues, will often feel that once they're published, they're finished, they're not going to perish. So now they can relax. And so they leave it at that. Publishers are worried about change because they have a very strong economy and market selling to libraries. What will happen if they change any aspect of that? So it isn't that we can't imagine a way of doing this. The biggest challenge has been helping people to see that there is a way, and that the risk is minimal and the good, or at least the risk can be managed, and that the good is great. And so that's been the biggest aspect of it.
Yeah, so it sounds like really what you're describing is there aren't real problems other than maybe people's willingness to do things differently.
Yeah, change is hard. And Ben, and I think that's a fair response. And I want to be respectful of people's insistence that, in fact, what we often hear is it's not broken. And in some ways, I would say, yes, the publishing, the quality of publishing is excellent.
Right.
And many, many new tools and devices online. You can leave comments. You can save PDFs. You can share them with friends. So all of these things are very, very good. And we don't want to disturb. That's we, the open access advocates like myself. We only want to change one thing, and that is the basis of access.
Right.
And we want to change that in a way that realizes people's right to this knowledge, while at the same time finding a funding model of support. And part of that is the research grants could pay for some of this. Part of it is that the libraries are supporting what are now closed, subscription, exclusive access journals in a way that they might be able to afford. Because when I say the libraries being involved, the libraries have always kept a place open for public, for what's called walk-in users, not members of the library, but walk-in users. So the libraries have always had an eye out or been on the lookout to help the public find access. And we think that they would be happy, and many of them have expressed an interest in finding a new way of paying for the journals, which do need to be paid for, but it pay for them in a way that would open or increase access for the public and for researchers around the world. Because part of this is a question about those who can afford access. There are many researchers and many institutions in the Global South who cannot afford access to expensive subscription journals. And, and do your listeners perhaps have any idea of how expensive a journal can be?
I don't know, but I'm sure it'd be nice if you filled us in.
Yes, because it was kind of a surprise to me. I was a professor for a decade or more before I'd even really learned what the price of journals were, because they just showed up in the library or on my screen. But it turns out they can be thousands of dollars. The extreme case, the one that people often refer to as Brain Research, a journal published by Elsevier, that's in the area of $20,000 to $30,000 a year for a subscription.
Wow.
The average in physics is about $3,500 a year.
Right.
So these are expensive publications, and part of that is it's a very small market compared to the New York Times or other publications. And part of it is because it's a very profitable industry at this point.
Yeah.
So that's part of the challenge, is trying to convince people that this is not a good place, or at least it isn't appropriate, perhaps, to make the highest possible profit when you're selling access to a public good.
Right.
And part of it is to say that we do respect the excellent work you're doing as a publisher, but we think there's an important principle that needs to be introduced, a principle of access, introduced into the equation.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm going to shift gears with you again a little bit here.
Absolutely.
There was a young woman I was just reading about, I believe in Russia, who was essentially making her own access. She was just taking all the papers she could and making them, putting them on servers and making them accessible to people. Do you think this works against what you're doing?
Yeah, so let's talk about Alexandria Elibakan. We know her well, and the site you're referring to is Sci-Hub.
Okay, yeah, there it is.
Because
Thank you.
It's a very interesting instance. It's not the solution by any means, but it's certainly, in fact, I often think of it as the Napster moment. When Alexandria managed to find a way to scrape the research articles off of many, many websites and create a free site for them. So she had, by the time we even learned about her, the first time she was sued, in fact, by one of the publishers, she had about 50 million articles freely available.
Wow.
She had complete journals. huge amount. And somehow she had gotten hold of passwords. Somehow she had, as it were, broken into databases and scraped the entire contents.
Mm-hmm.
And so Sci-Hub was a wake-up call in the sense that the traditional notion of how this knowledge was being distributed, she totally disrupted. Here it was, all freely available through her website. And, of course, the publishers went to court. The American Chemical Association, American Chemical Society, excuse me, went to court. The publisher Elsevier went to court to shut her down. And sure enough, they removed her site. At least they had her initial site closed. They pushed her further and further into the dark web.
Mm-hmm.
Into the deep web, she's now retreated to Moscow, and it's kind of a Snowden kind of situation where she's outside the reach of the law.
Right.
So I think it's a good example that, and oh, by the way, the use of her work. So who was using her work? She released some of her data. She was getting enormous number. I don't have it off the top of my head, but 40 million downloads sounds about right. Enormous number of downloads, not just in the global south, not just in impoverished countries, but just in Mountain View one of the major sites where this knowledge was being downloaded. People found it convenient. They felt they had a right to it. So it was disruptive in a number of ways. But the missing part from Sci-Hub is who's going to pay for the research. The libraries have paid for it. The publishers have taken the money and published it, and then she makes it free.
Right.
So we need to, she's been an example. She illustrates the interest people have in having this free access. We have students here. Sebastian Galvez is a student working on Sci-Hub doing an analysis of who's downloading the papers and how those papers are being used.
Mm-hmm.
So she's making a contribution. She's demonstrating that if this research was freely available, people are using it. You know, that whole thing, if you build it, will they come? She built it and they came. And they're continuing to come in huge numbers. So it is, as I can say it again, it is, I do see it as illegal. She has definitely stolen the material. She actually cites my book, The Access Principle, in her defense.
Mm-hmm.
In the case in New York, she didn't appear there, but she sent a letter to the judge. And while I definitely defend open access, I do not defend stealing the material. I want to do this in a legal fashion. And I think, as I said before, we have sufficient money to do that. So let Ellie Bakken and Sci-Hub stand as a reminder that there is a public interest and that we need an alternative model that is legal, that respects intellectual property rights, and at the same time serves the public and scholars everywhere far better than it does now.
Okay, yeah, thank you. That's so nice to think about this as a way to sort of break the ice into the real need to make this happen.
Yes, so. Yeah, breaking the ice is a good way. The charges were $150,000 per article Elsevier sued her for. and so we were at $12 to $15 million worth of, it did more than break the ice.
Yeah.
She's now in hiding and will not be traveling very much at all.
Well, I guess there's nothing we can do about it from here. So,
not yet.
So I wanted to ask you, so as an author, you got to have some conflicting feelings because you sell the books that you write.
Yes.
And I know you've made at least some, or I don't know, maybe all of your books available as an open access as well, which I think is you trying to walk the walk of your mantra, right?
Yeah, so that's been an interesting aspect. This new book, The Intellectual Properties of Learning, is published by the University of Chicago Press. And they were very good about it. We talked about how I could fulfill this commitment. Like, why am I at University of Chicago Press? I mean, they did such a good job of working with me. They, from the cover, which I do appreciate the yeah. beauty of the cover. But the copy editing, they helped improve the quality of knowledge, and, right. and there's no question about that. And at the same time, they were ready to experiment. So what I've done in the case of the intellectual properties of learning is they allowed me to put a final draft available here at Stanford online. If you do a search for intellectual properties of learning plus Stanford plus open access, you're bound to come across that site where you can download the final draft, not the published version.
Okay.
In fact, you can see if you compare, if you have the opportunity to compare the final draft and the published version, you can see the value that publishers add to the work.
Oh, wow. That's great. Yeah.
And at the same time, if you can't afford the book, then you can still have access to it.
Right.
And that to me is an important principle. And I was torn by the notion maybe I should not publish it at all. I should just put it out there. But one of the things that Chicago did, University of Chicago Press, is they helped me work with reviewers. They were able to obtain blind review, as we call them, blind reviewers, to obtain very high-quality reviewers and manage that whole process that, again, helped improve the book greatly.
Well, you know, it's so refreshing to see someone living out their ideals in their daily life and actually doing the things they talk about.
Thank you,
so thank you for all your work you're doing and for being the person that can be the example for your cause. And that's amazing. So we're just about out of time here. I just want to thank you for making the time to come talk with me today.
But not and, time for one more song.
Oh, we're going to play you out for the rest of the hour.
Okay.
Don't worry. Yeah, yeah. So we're out of time for talking, and I just wanted to thank you. And we're going to hear at least another song or two from John's band on the way out for till the top of the hour. This is the Modern Education Radio Hour here on KZSU Stanford. We really appreciate you tuning in today and look forward to seeing you again next week.